It's my pleasure to welcome Mark Moffett today to our colloquium series. Mark comes to us from the Smithsonian and the Natural History Museum, where he's an entomologist. And he's had a labyrinthine career, which of course is the very best kind, in my opinion, I think many others. He describes himself as a high school dropout with a deep love of biology, who after a trip, if I remember correctly, to South America, wrote a letter to E.O. Wilson, and then went on from this letter to become essentially his PhD student at Harvard. Mark is a gifted photographer. I recommend you check out his images on his website, which is called Dr. Bugs, appropriately, especially the beautiful micro landscapes. Mark's also written 4 books, The Human Swarm, Adventures Among Ants, Face to Face with Frogs, and The High Frontier, Exploring the Tropical Rainforest Canopy. So it's really a pleasure to have Mark here today. And Mark, you're free to take it away.
Hey, thanks so much, Jessica and Della. In this talk, I'm going to overview some of the major themes of canopy biology with an emphasis on how the discipline, which is usually thought of in terms of forests, can be broadened to encompass more ecosystems and ideas. So what I want to do is bring the study of canopy biology in a direction where people like you at the Santa Fe Institute can find ways to contribute to it. And so this is going to be, in short, a series of teasers. So I'm going to move you through all kinds of things in this talk. I had hoped to come to the Santa Fe Institute this fall to talk about and work on some issues concerning my most recent book. So I do hope you guys open up again some magical way in the next year or two, and I still have a chance to do that. And that book had to do with social identity and societies, basically merging psychology, anthropology, and recognizing some key attributes, I think, that have been overlooked about societies. But the canopies has been a love of mine going back very far in the past. We all have this perspective on trees, and as a child, we usually pursued it. So I will just start off by showing me, as I think a 10-year-old, up in the canopy in my backyard in Ohio, avoiding the dishes mostly, but also finding all kinds of creatures. So my mother would eventually track me down and I'd have to do my duties. But until then, I was in love with the tops of trees every day. And I grew up reading, as I think many of you do at the Santa Fe Institute, you can claim this, have grown up reading some of these early exploration books. And all these books you'd read about this perspective of the canopies. The canopy was this mysterious thing above you, receding in the distance, and there was very little you could say about it. There were certain things you could pick out. There were species like this giant squirrel in India, which was well known for centuries, all its color morphology and so forth, as big as a cat. You could see those, shoot them and bring them down and look at them. But there are all kinds of mysteries. For instance, when I was a student working in Latin America, this cotton candy caterpillar fell on my head from the forest, treetops above me. I don't know what it does normally. It was just one of these fabulous mysteries that we see more often in the canopy than we do near the ground, since we live at the ground. But exploring it has been a big deal for, 25, 30 years now. I had a book come out in the 90s about that called The High Frontier with Harvard University Press. And this is Pierre Berner, who's studying tree branches growing in an extreme slope in Costa Rica. You can see him painting rings around the branches. This is the book cover. And he'd come back and see how much those rings had separated through growth in the next year or so. Not surprisingly, trees on these kinds of situations topple over quite a bit. Pierre Berner was a bit of a crazy guy, now working in Madagascar, I believe. So accessing the canopy when you were an Alfred Russel Wallace usually meant going to one of the local people who could free climb into the trees. And there's still the possibility of doing that. I know a few people who do that for their research in the right kind of habitats. You can use other kinds of techniques just to introduce you to some of the developments that led to us starting to gather data from the canopy. Here's in Sri Lanka, they're using ladders step by step into the treetops. Here I am with Ed Wilson, my mentor, of course, father of biodiversity. We brought him on board to write a National Geographic story. I was photographer in this situation, and we wanted to get him up in the canopy. I nearly fell to my death, but there's really no time to tell these kinds of stories. So if there's any questions afterwards, but Ed had a grand time and never knew I had trouble with my climbing gear. The most common method of getting the canopy though is to use a bow and arrow. And this is Tim Lehman, who's studying that ficus, the fig that's growing up like a distended blood vessel along the side of this dipterocarp tree he's in. And you attach a line to the bow and arrow, shoot it over the next tree. In this case, he's already up one tree, shooting it over the next tree. And the arrow will go down to earth, where his assistant in the lower left, I think I even have a pointer there. Does that work? Awesome. His assistant will attach a line to it. He'll pull up the line and then they'll maneuver a rope into place so he can climb the adjacent tree as well. That's the usual method of doing it. I visited the Dynamics of Forest Fragments project though in, in Brazil and carried out about 30 pounds of bows and arrows and ropes and all this sort of stuff and met a guy named Jay Malcolm who was studying mammals there. And he walked up to me looking at all this stuff in puzzlement and pulled out this little loop, which you put around your feet, and he just inchworms up the trunk with this. Various Indians groups use this around the world. It only weighs an ounce or two. So the braver of you may try this. I don't know if I would. Here he is collecting a mammal trap. And then you get into more expensive things, like ones funded by usually the US government or other governments. The one at the Rin River in Washington where I took this has been taken down. This is a canopy crane. It is, you hire a guy that normally works in cities to come out into the forest and maneuver this crane from place to place so that you can deliver the researcher to any point in three-dimensional space he wants to go, he or she. And this canopy driver was having the time of his life being out there in the forest with the birds. So the canopy, starting from the ground, looking up, what you tend to see is a lot of connections. And those connections are interesting, when, particularly when they're botanical. All kinds of things are going up and down the trees. So I'm just gonna mention a couple things quickly. What are these various growths here? They can be quite a variety of things. This is Christian Sampier, who was a graduate student at this time. He's now the head of the Wildlife Conservation Society, holding a hemiepiphyte, I believe it's a clusia, a root. And the roots of these plants can be about the fastest growing in the world. Hemiepiphytes are, their seeds are deposited in the canopy by birds. And as they grow their root, the root extends down as fast as they can make it go. A couple feet a day apparently is the record, or maybe even more, until they can root into the ground. And they are canopy plants, but with a ground connection. The most amazing of those are the strangler figs, which no doubt you've heard of, but if you ever get to Costa Rica or elsewhere, you should check them out. They're quite remarkable, because you can walk up to one of these things and look in, and it's often hollow down the middle, and you can actually climb up the center of them. And there's actually a second researcher down here, research assistant down here, and one here, climbing up this thing. It's like a three-dimensional ladder with all kinds of creatures moving up through these and into the canopy. Vines, of course, start from the bottom and grow up. They have quite a variety of ways of doing it. This is a species that uses little kind of hooks that go in, another hooking mechanism like a pitchfork. This one has lateral roots. This one has tendrils, and tendrils grow faster on the side that's not touching the object. So I actually moved this little tree here, sprouting tree or shrub next to this growing vine until it touched the tree, and then it started wrapping. And this is 24 hours later. My goodness, you can actually watch the move as these tendrils climb on. And then the main stem continues to grow up for another foot or two till it sends out its next tendril. Vines are really worthy of much more study. Jack Putz and some others have worked on them for a while, but you walk through the rainforest and you see this bizarre configurations of vines all over the place. And if you could determine how to read those configurations, you'd know the history of the forest. In this case, in French Guiana, you see a friend of mine standing in a spot where clearly there once was a tree that fell down, but the vines withstand all kinds of destructive forces as the trees come and go and hold them in their memory in terms of their shape. Now, I've done a couple general reviews of canopy biology. That's sort of the basis for me talking about these things today. This one was from 6 years ago, and I'd be glad to send it to anyone who wants to look at it. My point of view, I study ants. My belief is that we're too anthropomorphic about how we look at canopies. We tend to think of things as of bigger than us as being a canopy, but you have to ask, for example, what a canopy looks like to an ant. And there you get all kinds of potentially interesting things going on as ants move through a similar kinds of labyrinth, even in meadows and smaller kinds of vegetation. So I'm going to be investigating that idea by defining canopy more broadly than some do, as parts of any community of sessile organisms that emerge from a substratum, the structural products derived from them included. And so that can include, of course, and the most important line is the end there. I think what really distinguishes canopy biology as an area of study is it treats communities as three-dimensional. This architecture and labyrinth of structure is what interests. So you can go right down to grasslands and even mowed lawns. Bastel Wilson, some of you may know his name, in New Zealand, an ecologist, has studied mowed lawns and finds that they have multiple layers, even if they're a couple centimeters thick, and all kinds of complexity compressed within them. And to an ant, of course, that's a very interesting kind of structure to deal with. You can't fit as much biodiversity in that space, but you have to deal with many of the same problems that you have in a forest if you're an ant, even within that smaller space. And then there's the question of marine canopies. And incidentally, the word canopy has been used for all these communities at one time or another. I'm not unique in coming up with the idea, but it hasn't been treated as something that can be used across all the communities until I did so. This is a seagrass community, saltwater marsh. Then the kelp forests are, of course, fascinating. There are all kinds of things about them, you can say, for one reason or another, perhaps by accident, perhaps not. Kelp forests are generally described as having five strata, and so are most rainforests and other forests. And then I started looking at microbial communities, and periphyton is something we don't think enough of. Palm scum does not get its fair shakes because it's fascinating stuff. It's hard to get information on a lot of them. And so I started just poking around, and this is a picture I found of periphyton in a book about filtration systems. And what's really cool here is that there are stalks here that are basically equivalent to the trees of this system, going all the way to the top, the canopy, if you want to call the top the canopy in this case. And going up them are these little ones that are going in a circle. And the authors of this paper describe them as using circumnutation, which is the term that Darwin used to describe vines and how they climb up the canopy in a spiral. They're also epiphytic species, diatoms that live at the top layer of this system. And down here, this is just just the filtration system. Even more awesome, of course, are biofilms. A lot of cool research coming out about them, of course, because they have various problems with our pipes and so forth, but they're also just amazing systems in the first place. They are not films. They're not continuous films. They consist of microcolonies in most cases. And if you look at this structure, and this is one from the Center of Biofilm Engineering, a diagram, you see they actually form the bacteria in mass, come together and create a fluid in which they live that turns into the form more or less of trees and are often stratified. These are microcolonies, individual microcolonies here. So I'll just say for these, of course, what's really interesting is there are movements of nutrients from the outside into these systems and how the different parts of the microcolonies and different microcolonies get nutrients, where it comes from. This is all part of the system that's being studied now. And it's the same for forests. So here's a nice view of a tropical rainforest. You have here Nalini Nadkarni and Jack Longino, two preeminent researchers of the canopy at the University of Utah. And they're on a tree in the Monte Verde, Costa Rica, which is just wall to wall with epiphytes. And you gotta ask yourself, what's supporting all this life? And what Nalini is most known for, going back to her original research, is recognizing that most of the soil in the forest was actually up in the trees. Here she's cut away all the epiphytes on a branch, and you can see this layer of soil down below. And within that layer are roots, not only of the epiphytes, but these are roots of the tree itself. And a great many tropical trees root in their own canopies because the soil on the ground is so thin and it's so rich in the treetops. So the question became initially for her, where all this soil comes from. And it's still one of my favorite experiments. I'm not sure if you're aware of this stuff, whiteout. It's a little bit outdated now. But here are some leaves with whiteout marks on them that she scattered over the canopy. And she's found out, she thought, well, maybe the leaves decay up there, but they all blew away pretty quickly. And so it had to have come from somewhere else. So she and her team did all kinds of experiments on decay, turnover, and so forth, and basically came to the conclusion that the nutrients were coming from outside the system entirely. And this is Ken Clark, a researcher now at U.S. Forest Service, I believe, collecting dew that's going over the mountain pass in Costa Rica in streaming winds. You can see the little wind blown there. The dew collects on those Teflon strings and goes down into those buckets. And there's a lot of nutrients in that dew. And if you look closely, particularly in the cloud forest, of course, there's just so much moisture coming in from the mist all the time. You'll see that there's accretions of soil everywhere. So this is a leaf of a bromeliad. And on the bromeliad are two baby bromeliads, perhaps the offspring of the mommy right here, growing in soil that's probably spent a long time to build up on the leaf of the parent plant. And in fact, in the rainforest, it's thought that the canopy soil can take decades to accumulate. So I'm gonna go into what I consider some of the core issues of canopy biology, sort of the issues that make canopies interesting as a subject. All these issues are overlapping, and things like nutrient cycling, which I just went through quickly, can be studied from all these perspectives. And I'll mostly be using examples from forest canopies. So community ecospace, by that I mean sort of the space in which organisms experience the canopy. Now you can look at a tree like this. You see, this is, I believe, ficus, yeah, and the figs are growing right against the trunk. So it's attracting species that have very little capacity to getting out into the canopy itself. They can climb the trunk and no more. So things like the binturong, this is in Borneo, I believe. So that species can probably get to those figs, but not much else. Other species like the orangutan can experience the canopy in three dimensions, but there are large holes in where it can go. It can only reach certain branches and move around in certain places. Other species, of course, can go just about anywhere, birds, for example, but even they can be excluded from areas of very dense vegetation. Now, ants have been modeled, this was a model in Science for a few years ago, as if they experienced the canopy as a volume. They do not. You think about it, an ant cannot access most of that space. What they are experiencing is basically what amounts to a highly warped surface. And so when we see this, an ant, like here's an ant in particular, this is Oligomyrmex atomicus, it's the smallest ant. The heads of these minor workers are the size of a paramecium. They're walking along on a surface that might as well be this. There's a tenebrionid beetle on top of a dune in the Namib Desert. And that little ant in the treetop probably has experienced the same kind of world. And it's a very bizarre world because the acceleration of branches in the wind is much greater than that of gravity. So it may be that these ants often simply don't know which way is which. And it can be kind of a strange Einsteinian space where you walk in one direction and find yourself back where you started, or you circle the branch, you go to another direction, you end up at the end of the world, at the tip of the last branch, and come back and walk in the other direction, and you eventually leave the tree and are never seen again. Another one of these core areas is host architecture. And when you climb trees, host architecture ends up being really important to you. For example, would you put a rope up this tree? No way. This tree is gonna, you're not gonna last a second up there. The branches are gonna crack. There's no place to hold on to and so forth. Now, the really interesting thing is that there are only so many ways of making a tree. Francis Halle and his colleagues have refined the taxonomy of these architectures. There are about 29 of them, I think, now. And some of them are conducive and promote animal visits and some don't. So here's a tree that looks very pleasant for climbing indeed, and you might see animals in it all the time. The really one thing that has not been done is really look at canopy animals in terms of how they navigate this space. When we do mazes for animals, they're always some kind of weird arbitrary shape. No one's really looked at the architecture of actual trees and seen how animals are able to move through them, how they can solve problems in those spaces. But the thing is that if you include the vines, you can find well-beaten trails in canopies that have probably been there for generations and used by many different species, linking the best roots through the best trees to the best food sources. No one's ever followed those trails or seen who uses them altogether. So it's, again, a really fundamental part of the dynamics of the canopy that needs to be studied. I'll just mention one other thing quickly that's really cool about canopy trees. Again, a possibility for further research. This is Francis Halle, the inventor of the taxonomy of tree types, tree architectures, holding part of the trunk of a tree where he's peeled away the branches. And you can see that there are different masses of roots going into the trunk. And it turns out that many tropical trees, particularly the big ones, are like colonial animals. They form iterations and branch off of each other, often in a place where there's been some damage to the tree. And this allows them to be very dynamic and to grow in various directions, depending on the availability of light and so forth. So it's very important to pick your direction. Here's a Patis monkey I was fortunate to see in Africa who went the wrong way. It couldn't figure out how to get out of this thorny bush. Do not do that if you're a monkey. Now, dealing with these architectures is part of the problem that most of the world species face, right down to the smallest ones. So a guy named Rudolf Jander at Kansas some years ago discovered that ants can actually efficiently search tree surfaces by using a certain pattern of movement. On the ground, ants do best if they move rather randomly around. Brownian motion works pretty well. But on the trees, the rule is turn, say, left when you reach a tip, like the end of a leaf, and right when you reach a branch. And you'll eventually circle each of the leaves on this branch completely. Turns out, for example, that leafcutter ants are lefties. Another fascinating thing to me about the canopy is the difficulties of remembering things in three dimensions. It turns out Lucia Jacobs at Berkeley has shown that squirrels have a lot of trouble remembering where things are up in the trees. They normally bury things in two dimensions on the ground. But this animal is brilliant at it. You wouldn't think so. It's a lowly amphibian, not much of a brain compared to a squirrel, and yet I can't tell you the whole story. I've spent several weeks following these frogs. These are poison dart frogs, in this case in Panama. These frogs normally live on the ground, but they reproduce by going up in the trees and depositing their eggs in bromeliads, in little watery pools in the center of a bromeliad. So mother goes up in the tree, leaves a an egg, finds another bromeliad somewhere else and leaves another egg, and she scatters her eggs through the canopy. And she comes back at intervals, so she has to remember where all those young are, and she actually feeds them a little infertile egg throughout their lives. And she has to be very cautious about it because there are all kinds of canopy creatures up there, including canopy crabs that will eat the tadpoles. That's why she spreads out her young. But she manages to remember where all these things, these young are spread out among the trees. Here she is with the tadpole baby behind her. However, most brilliant of all, and a group that really deserves your full attention, are the solticids, or jumping spiders. These little characters are hopping around outside your building right now. They eat mosquitoes and so forth. They don't make webs, but they are very visual. They actually understand TV. They're just not interested in it unless there's another spider on the tube. That's how well they can see, though. And there are all kinds of things to be said about them, but one of the most remarkable was discovered a few years ago by a guy named David Hill. This is from his original paper. And that is that a jumping spider, if it sees, say, a fly in the middle of the vegetation, will look around and find what he calls secondary objectives, back away out of the view of the fly, circle around a bit to another spot and look again and keep doing these detours until he gets close enough to the fly to catch it. There are a bunch of really good research on these solticids. Their ability to handle and remember things in three dimensions develops in their youth. So Elizabeth Jacobs at the University of Massachusetts has shown that if you raise a jumping spider in a box with nothing in it, it can't deal with these kinds of problems. It can't solve this problem. But if you add one stick, it can start to manage to solve complex problems in three dimensions. It has to grow up in that environment. And it's the same, it turns out, with marmosets, the monkey. If you have marmosets from zoos that are very simplified environments, when they're released to the forest, they have a lot of trouble getting around. Okay, another area is open space. Open space includes most obviously gaps and questions of light as a resource in this case, but there are all kinds of smaller spaces going on as well. including Lightflex. And this Jose Luis Mercado here is using a fisheye lens to see where all the Lightflex are all around these seedlings. And you can calculate how much light they're going to get in the course of the day, which will determine their chances of survival. So every point in the canopy within the open, with all these little openings, has these opportunities for gathering light resources. One of the most remarkable theses I ever have seen is Martin Aluja. He's down in Mexico, you might know his name, does a lot of interesting things, but he managed to map out a apple tree so in such detail that he could map the movements of flying fruit flies through the trees and see how they maneuvered to find the fruit. An amazing amount of work. But all, you know, again, all canopy animals have to deal with these things in one way or another. A major problem if you're in the canopy as well is the crown shyness as well. You have your gaps and then you have things like crown shyness. Crown shyness is the separation between crowns due to both abrasion sometimes, but also just the growth patterns of the trees that stop short of each other. And those lead to spaces that can be a third of a meter or more wide. And this makes the canopy quite a difficult place. For humans, of course, particularly getting from one tree to another is tricky. This is Steve Sillett transferring between trees, but for animals of all kinds as well. When you have a something like this possum here, it is actually a difficult size animal, a difficult sized animal for the canopy. It's not big enough to bounce the branch and build up enough speed to go flying over to the next branch in a big leap. And so it tends to get stuck in a tree at that size. And for that reason, it's thought that a disproportionate number of canopy animals tend to be mammals, tend to be monkey size, where they can really use the branch as a springboard. There's also the question of gliding to get around. And one of the fascinating discoveries a few years ago was the fact that ants can glide. It was thought that small things like ants probably couldn't glide for the longest time. But people like me, stuck up in the tree with Jack Longio, my ant friend, would notice every once in a while that an ant would look at us, and it seemed to leap off the branch, and the speck just seemed to float down and land on the tree again. And so it was discovered by Steve Janovic at Louisville that ants do glide. This is my picture of a gliding ant. I took 6,000 frames. This is the only one that was wasn't completely black. And this is in its posture, which you see is similar to the posture of the parachuting human. And in fact, the ant can control its descent and land on the tree trunk. If you can't glide, there are other things you can do as an ant. You might think that you could get stuck in that same tree because of that crown shyness, but it turns out the weaver ant, this species here, has a technique. The ants accumulate where they want to go to the next tree and grab onto each other until a little finger of live ants extends out. And then eventually the two trees will rock together in the wind and the ants at the tip of the finger will grab on and suddenly you have a chain of ants going from one tree to the next. This has to be the worst job in the ant colony because you get stuck there for days, but everyone else gets to go over there across and get food from the other tree. Tom Ray, who did the Tierra project on evolution a few years ago, Oklahoma, I believe he is, studied nomadic vines, and they're truly extraordinary. They are the philodendrons in your doctor's office. Don't look like much, but he discovered that they sprout when the birds droppings land on the ground, and the seedlings move away from the light towards the nearest tree trunk. They can actually see the tree trunk in a sense by detecting the kind of light coming around them in different places and distinguishing the trees. And so they start climbing the trees, and as they go up the trees, they unfurl the leaves we see in the dentist office. And when they get to the top and need to cross to the next tree, it turns out they grow a long terminal shoot or leader shoot, can be several feet long, that topples over, and eventually one of them lands on the other tree, can grab on, and the philodendron can cross over to the next tree. If it fails to do that and falls to the ground, it has no problem. If an orchid falls to the ground, it will die, but a philodendron simply uncoils itself and starts climbing up the tree again. What makes them unique is that they only stay a few feet long. They always lose the roots to earth. So they behave essentially like arboreal snakes, moving around through the canopy looking for light. Okay, properties of structural elements. These are things like, you know, stiffness and pH and all sorts of things. There are all kinds of possible research avenues there. The potential for getting out to the branch tips where the food is important. So even a relatively large species like a chimpanzee potentially has to be a good botanist to know whether a branch can hold its weight and allow it to get to the food. The robustness of the branches also leads to all kinds of things happening with the canopy community. So I showed you this picture before, and there are so many epiphytes here that you can't even tell where the tree is. In fact, this branch here could well be a different tree. There are actually trees growing on trees in the rainforest. That's particularly true in the Pacific Northwest. I've climbed redwoods where the soil at some of the top branches can be 2 foot thick, and there are trees growing in the soil up there. And there are also terrestrial earthworms up there that manage to climb through the narrow bits of soil along the trunk going right up into the treetops. Same as climbing up through the soil. You just keep going up the tree. You can also do things with surfaces. Ants, snakes rely on all kinds of rugose or broken surfaces to hold on and use various climbing techniques. Things like canopy salamanders have little sticky feet. One of the concerns of being in the canopy is inadvertent signaling, and canopy snakes are all very long and skinny, and they can spread their body out so that the vibrations of the moving are spread over a number of different supports, and they cantilever forward without any sign of them coming and nab lizards. And the lizards up there, like the Sonolus, tend to sleep at the tips of leaves where they are unlikely to be not detect a snake coming. I mean, up there at the tip, you can feel any vibration at all, but the snakes still steal their way forward. This is a cricket that I collected in Little Barrier Island in New Zealand and got the Guinness Book of World Records, 72 grams. And even at its size, it was climbing trees. And have been studied by Larry Field and other orthopterans. And the really interesting thing there is the communication by all these guys includes signaling that carries through the branches, and the branches transform the signals. So the potential is rather great, and there's some work done to suggest that, you know, a katydid or a giant cricket, a weta, this is called, like this, can actually detect from an incoming signal where in the tree or shrub the sender is, where it's located, what branch and height it's at. Host distribution is a big one, of course, and that is true because in tropical canopies, my main concern, you can have 1,000 species of tree in a hectare. And Dan Jansen, of course, came out with his paper, Host Plants as Islands, in the 1960s. And this is a really important aspect of canopy biology, They're not just islands, they're adjacent to each other. So I call it a patchwork biogeography, a patchwork of all different kinds of trees, many of which will have specialist species of insects that eat its leaves and so forth, living on that kind of tree. Then superimposed on this patchwork of trees, you have what are called ant mosaics. You may have seen some of the research on this, showing some of the dominant ants have territories that it can extend quite broadly, sometimes over several trees, and the ants are very aggressive at supporting certain species that they want and getting rid of everything else they don't. So each ant colony can have a whole community based around it. Now, stratification is a big one. There have been complaints about stratification because it's been used, the word has been used in various ways, and I think it, how you view stratification will depend on the kind of resident or the attribute that you're interested in. But you know, in general, you can pick out different layers. So you have emergent trees like this one here, upper canopy trees, mid-story trees, and you can see in this case, this is along the Amazon where the river has been undercut the forest and given you a clean view. And this is an open space that a lot of birds and other animals might be able to use. So bats and so forth are famous for going into that narrow corridor between the upper canopy and the midstory. And a lot of the fruits that, and flowers that the bats feed on extend down into that open area. Now, and here's a example of a study, this is a few years old, of NASA's in Costa Rica, of a tower that extended up through all the layers of the canopy. And you see Jeff Laval still working at NASA there, and he's gathering data through all the canopy layers right down to the ground. And the really interesting thing about the canopy, of course, is that a short distance going up vertically is equal in effect to moving a much longer horizontal distance. You can travel for miles to get the changes in habitat that you can get in a short distance moving up into the forest. And that is an essential attribute of forests and a vertical structure in general that is worthy of a lot of study. Nighttime in the forest, resting away. This is Kathy Langtum out at night. She's a researcher who has been studying a number of things about canopy vertebrates. She studied mice, and it turns out that the sounds that the mice make are different at different heights. I forget if the ones that are musical are at the canopy or at the ground, I forget. The other ones are lousy sounding. The other thing she studied is the color of canopy mammals. Mammals tend to be brown, nocturnal mammals tend to be brown in the canopy and gray at the ground. And it's believed that so they can match the background brightness on a moonlit night. So brown apparently pays off if you're gonna hide from predators in the canopy. Moving through all these layers also means risks, but it depends who you are. If you're a frog, you're small enough, there is no risk. And in fact, there's a frog in Puerto Rico. This is the coqui frog. The frogs are the most abundant amphibian in the world. There are 40,000 of them per hectare, and they all say coqui together. So it's very noisy every night in Puerto Rico. And at daybreak, well, they're up in the canopy all night eating flies and whatnot. And at daybreak, they save time on the commute by all dropping at the same time. At sunrise, it rains frogs in Puerto Rico. This allows them to avoid not only the time on the commute, but all kinds of predators that might be looking for them. So I was out at daybreak and it's literally raining frogs. At that size, falling is no problem. At the upper end of canopy life and size, you have the spectacled bear. This is a species in Colombia. Good story getting this picture. It was a little bit crazy. These animals are big enough weigh as much as a large human, that they have to be very cautious on getting the canopy. They are canopy animals. They eat epiphytes, but they have to cross over the ground to get to the next tree. Even at the size of an iguana, you have to be cautious. So large iguanas have to hang out over water, and they're willing to leap into the water if you bother them. But normally, they are very cautious about leaping anywhere else. Of course, humans are concerned about height all the time, which is why, you know, why did I start off with all this stuff about climbing techniques? Why is it such a big deal? It's because for us, height is a big deal. And I want to make a message here that for canopy animals, it's different. Height doesn't matter. At least absolute height does not matter to most canopy animals. It's different if you live on the ground. Okay, no lecture is complete without the pizza rat. And this is a ground animal. This kind of rat has been studied for its orientation quite a bit, including in three-dimensional space. And compared to the orientation space by a canopy animal, the marmoset, turns out the rat, which normally lives on the ground, when it climbs up, it knows exactly how high it is at all times. It eats track precisely of its height. The marmoset rarely even seems to know where it is in height. It doesn't seem to worry about height. In fact, a marmoset, if you disturb it, will leap out of the tree at the moment's notice and bounce on the ground and run away. They're at a weight that doesn't cause them problems. And so you go up and up and up, and the height really doesn't matter for one reason, because you have this false sense of security if you're a human. You no longer see the ground if you're high enough. And this is looking down from a sequoia. And so you just don't even know how high you are. So that's one reason not to be concerned about, the canopy animals may not be aware of their absolute heights. But the other one is that they simply don't have to. I climbed the world's tallest tree with a team. We got to the very top branch, and at the top branch, at the top twig going off to the side, as California redwood, was a mouse dropping. And we decided it was lover's leap for mice, because it could go up there and leap if it wanted, and it would still be fine. And I call this idea the critical injury height, the height at which you're likely to hurt yourself. And this is certainly a big part of life in the canopy for different species and how they deal with the problem. Steve Vogel came up with the figure of 100 grams, below 100 grams, and you can't be hurt by a fall. Even larger animals, though, do fall often in the canopy. So gibbons will simply casually reach out and grab the next branch. You speak of the safety factor to failure of the branches, and presumably, again, gibbons must be fairly good botanists and other animals up there to know which branch to go on and which branches to avoid. Haldane said all this first. He said you could drop a mouse down a 1,000-yard mine shaft and, arriving at the bottom, it gets a slight shock and walks away. A rat is killed, a man is broken, and a horse splashes. Canopy life matters much more in terms of the environment than the heights of the creatures that live in it. So when you look at anolis lizards like this one, you'll find that they stratify not at particular heights, but they are finding branches of the right diameter and a temperature that they like, wherever that is. So Doug Reagan is one of the researchers who's worked on this, and he showed after a big hurricane that all the lizard species moved down because the broken branches moved down, and they just moved with them. David Rubik has shown, you know, there are cases where you do need to know relative height at least, and David Rubik at the STRI has shown that the stingless bees can actually, some of them at least, can actually convey height, communicate height, and they do that either by marking scents as they go up, so you simply follow a scent trail like you would an ant, or by making sound bursts in the nests, and the time between the sound bursts indicates how high in the trees the food is. So I'm going to just conclude with a story or two and hope you've enjoyed things so far. But the really amazing thing about canopies is the three-dimensional aspect of them. This height dimension in particular augments productivity, provides all kinds of habitats, and the same square foot of ground surface can offer all kinds of diversity, a scaffolding for species richness. And for theorists, there have to be rules by which the ecosystems assemble with all this three-dimensional glory. And I think we need to look at that across these different systems, particularly since a lot of these things have to do with biodiversity. And biodiversity particularly has to do with insects. And insect biodiversity particularly has to do with this fellow, Terry Irwin, recently deceased, sadly, who's the fellow who came up with the reassessment of the number of species on Earth, 10 times what had been thought before. And I've worked, been down with him in Ecuador and Peru. And here he is collecting insects with a fogger, and all those insects fall down below where you hear the sounds of scientists mumbling names, pretending they know what they're talking about. Well, in this case, they actually know what they're talking about because there's Douglas Fatuma and Brian Farrell looking at the insects. And from a single tree, you get this pile of insects. This is Michael Pogue, Terry's assistant. This is actually a third of the insects. And Terry calculated that there are 100,000 species of insects per square hectare, per hectare, and 10 trillion individuals per hectare of insects in where he was studying in Tipitina, Ecuador. So a quick story at the end, because I like to tell stories too. The coolest, most wonderful way of experiencing the canopy, if you can, you can get some funding for these guys, is the Radu de Seams, the canopy raft. This is a French operation that has built these giant pontoon structures where you can go right up into the treetops and study the trees yourselves. This is Meg Lohman, who works on herbivory. And they have the world's largest dirigible. And one option for the studies is to use this little pontoon raft that's below the dirigible there. You see it here. Here's one scientist, is another. And you just point, and the dirigible operator moves you in that direction. And here we are, and it's very exciting up in this contraption. And I have my insect net to collect. And we're telling the pilot, go this way, go this way. And he goes down and sweeps into the forest. And I grab my net and throw it forward to grab a sample, and realize too late that there's a wasp colony right in front of me. And I slam my net into the wasp colony. And luckily, the pilot moved us out of there pretty fast. But no method of canopy orientation and moving around is foolproof. The most fun, though, sometimes is something simpler. This is Jack Longino, an insect buddy of mine in Monteverde, Costa Rica. And we just decided to start climbing the tree as high as we could. And we kept going and going until we stuck our heads out of the top. And this is the upper surface of the canopy going off in the distance. And all those layers down below us are what I want you to think about now, and what those mean, and how, I mean, we can actually study these things and put them all together. And I'll conclude by saying that there's also the possibility of gathering more information of the root systems, because those are even less known. I call the prospect of looking at plants or fixed communities in general, generally from above or below their substrates, structural ecology, the structural ecology of the ecosystem. There's very little on root systems and natural situations. You can go back to some of the early reports and get some nice drawings, but people have not been pursuing this enough. Anyway, thanks so much. I've talked for quite a bit now. One of my hopes is to put together a work group of people working across these different types of ecosystems to start getting a vocabulary that makes sense to all of us, and start looking at problems we can address together. So that's a long-term ambition. Glad for any questions.
Thank you so much, Mark. That was great. So who's got questions? So I have one.
Yep.
So you reviewed some really amazing adaptations that these creatures at different levels in the canopy have. What's known about the rate at which the behavior changes and the underlying cognition changes?
Not enough. I mean, there's some really interesting ideas scattered about. One of my favorite papers, let's see if I wrote this down here. Yeah, Dan Polvinelli and what is his name? John Kant wrote a paper for Quarterly Review of Biology. Look, what's it called? It's here in this list. Arboreal Clamoring and the Evolution of Self-Conception. And their idea for our ancestry is that arboreal life at a big enough size requires a lot of understanding of our own bodies. So a squirrel monkey can use very very stereotyped kinds of movements to go through the canopy. Run on a branch, leap, run on the branch, leap, go up the tree, all stereotyped. But an orangutan cannot. It literally has to know where all parts of its body are, how they're relating, and how they're moving compared to the surfaces it's holding on to. And this idea intrigued me, and it hasn't been pursued enough, for example. Just this is one example.
Other questions?
Yeah. Andy. Mark, that was a really interesting talk. And at the very end, you mentioned sort of roots and root systems, where we see all these interactions between fungal pathogens and fungal mycorrhiza. But up in the canopy, the fungi are sort of assembling as the immune system of the plant. Do you know if ants play any active or passive plant in dispersing those fungi? Or is it all just chance and sort of being blown around?
Well, I'm sure they do, but I don't think anyone's particularly addressed the problem. So that's an interesting question. I mean, as in so many of these things, it's really wide open. There are very odds and ends sorts of research being done. There's a fellow studying water bears in the canopy of the world, for example, but there's vast areas that for which there's very little information. And certainly the microbial life is one of them. Of course, the very upper canopy, that upper surface that you saw in that photograph is almost desert-like. Water runs right through that to the lower levels. And that's really the marvel of this whole thing, is you have so much range of habitat in one place. So presumably the microflora and fauna is much richer on the ground, but how it relates to the tree surfaces, and particularly on leaves, where they're actually important and taking up nutrients and actually depositing nutrients to the plants, and the role of the ants and all that, all open questions.
Other questions? Michael Garfield, did you have a question?
Yeah, I'm just curious about, you know, what this means in terms of search. You know, like these ants, frogs, jumping spiders, they're navigating labyrinthine spaces with very limited cognitive resources. So how are their heuristics evolving for exploring these specific topologies?
Now, as I say, I mean, it's just wide open. I would love for someone to go visit Francis Hallet in France right now. I'd love to go visit him in France right now and look at all these architectures and how they tend to interrelate and build models of how space actually looks for animals, and then see how the cognition of canopy species relates to those structures. We're just making, you know, mazes that have nothing to do with real life for these creatures. They're solving, you know, lab mazes and psychology labs that don't teach us anything.
But a question. So does the spatial structure in the canopy have a fractal aspect to it in the sense that it applies all the way down? Or is it really something, the complexity, that appears at large scale? So it would only be really the bigger organisms for which these cognitive questions are interesting?
Yeah, well, it might be mostly the bigger organisms. I think the fractal aspects become more prominent as you go towards the microbial end. And of course, that's important even in tree canopies, because there's a lot going on there. And then there are really interesting, just to throw out another thing that comes to mind, really interesting connections between ecosystems. For example, streams going under forests have different algal communities. They're basically similar to mid-story algal communities in a sunlit algal site. So their whole community is structured by the forest above them, even though it's far overhead and so forth. So looking at these things across these different systems is also part of the what should be done, I guess.
Interesting. Other questions? Comments?
Anyone? Question?
Michael?
Yes. Great talk, Mark. What's Thanks. Known about food web structure in these canopies? In particular, as you go up through a canopy, do you get fewer upper trophic levels like predators and parasites?
Yeah, well, those are great questions. And there are a few people that have data that could go in that direction in terms of providing some answers, but I haven't seen too much published. In the last couple of years, I mean, to me, the whole issue of this how a square foot on the ground, the alpha diversity you get there is enhanced by all these layers above and all that diversity and above. And how that adds incrementally to biodiversity is just being dealt with at the crudest level now, let alone figuring out the food web aspects of it. A lot of species, for example, are known to be tourists. They move through the trees going somewhere else. They live somewhere else. In some cases, we don't know where they live because each species of tree can have apparently thousands of endemic species to it. But how those actually form a web is a great unknown.
Any other questions before we thank Mark? All right, Mark, awesome talk. We really appreciate you giving it.
Excellent.
Thank you. And as I say, if you're interested in that paper, send it along, because I do think there's lots of opportunities for research. I mostly did this in order to entice you to think about ideas, not to give you many answers, as you can tell.
Lots of fun. Thank you.